Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming on this Saturday afternoon. My name is Lesley Ma, curator of ink art at M+. First of all, I want to thank the Art Basel organizers, Adeline Uy, Stephanie Bailey, Louise Orem, for inviting me to moderate such a prestigious panel. And thank you for all the panelists for being here today. We will be talking about modernisms in Asia through the lens of galleries, collections, and exhibitions. Each speaker comes from a very specific vantage point, and we hope to take this chance to look at the development of modernism in a very global and comparative way. In the next hour or so, we will hear from each of them about their experience exhibiting works of modernism and challenging the challenges and opportunities they have encountered as they reconstruct or stay at the forefront, consciously or unconsciously define modernism through the artists they show and the exhibitions they make. We'll also touch on the outlook for the future. I would do a little plug at M+, the new visual culture museum in Hong Kong, where our work. We are particularly interested in telling the stories of modernisms in Asia, an area of visual art that plays a crucial role in the story of modernism in Asia across the disciplines in visual art, design, architecture, and moving image. So it's a modernism not just limited to the visual side. My own specialty is in ink, an area of visual art that plays a crucial role in the story of modernism in Asia. As you see, the title of this panel is Ink and Paint. My work tries to trace the development of artistic expressions informed by and responding to the ink painting and calligraphy traditions and the dialogues and exchanges between artists inside Asia and outside of Asia. So one could only dream of talking of modernisms in Asia for a whole afternoon, but we only have 90 minutes. So we'll have about an hour or so of discussions, and then we'll open up to the floor for questions. So I will introduce each person on stage, if you allow me to flip through my papers and not get things wrong. Hozu Yamamoto-san on my left, together with his brother Yukihito Tabata-san, have been the co-directors of Tokyo Gallery since 1980. The gallery was founded by their father in 1950 and began showing both European and American modern art, such as informal and abstract expressionism. They also were the gallery that showed works by the first generation of post-war Japanese artists, Korean artists, and also avant-garde artists in China. And then it follows by Amna, Naqvi. Whose AAN collection is the largest private collection of visual art from Pakistan, spanning across modern and contemporary Pakistani art. It has loaned works to museums around the world, and she also co-runs the AAN Gandhara space that's more contemporary based and makes exhibitions internationally, such as Paris and Hong Kong and Hong Kong Art Center. And then followed by Johnson Chang, somebody probably needs no introduction, but I'll indulge myself. Since 1977, has been running Hanart Gallery and has been in the forefront of Chinese contemporary art. He's an important curator and a gallerist, as well as a scholar. Followed by Tina Keng, our guest who started her career in the Dimensions Art Center, in the legendary gallery in Taiwan, and then co-founded Lin and Lin Gallery and opened Tina Keng Gallery in 2000. Focused her gallery program on the first generation of Chinese modernist artists, many of them studied in Paris. Last but not least, David Tay, to the very end of this line, independent curator, assistant professor in the Department of English Language and Literature at the National University of Singapore. He's an author of Thai Art, Currencies of the Contemporary, in 2017, published by MIT Press, and recently a curator of the Guangzhou Biennale in 2018. So, thank you all for indulging me in that. My question, the first one, is for Yamamoto-san. So, what do you see, as I said, you have a long history of the gallery. What do you see as you and your gallery's role in uncovering modernism? What was the gallery's intention of showing modern art from Japan? From Europe first and Japan, but also showing Japanese artists, Chinese artists, and Korean artists also in your gallery.
Hi.
Yes. My name is Yamamoto from Tokyo Gallery. Thank you very much for the audience for coming. I was born in 1948. So when I was born, and then after two years after I was born, he operated in Tokyo, the gallery. And Japan has 150 years of history in our gallery. Well, actually, the Japan was modernizing, and at the same time, in line with that, Japan's art has to be modernized. In 1950, my father established the gallery. At that time, Japan was learning from Europe the oil painting. And he tried very hard to establish the oil painting. However, culture and environment is totally different. Therefore, after the Second World War, he thought that he has to have his Japan's own version of oil painting. And then after that, I think he expanded Korean artists and Chinese artists. As you can see from these photos, what is the Japanese style oil painting? That is, well, this is the oil painting which has to fit with the Japanese culture and Japan's climate. So Japanese artists, what they have done is to put the ink and also sand into the oil paint. So those are the works they have done, and at the same time, Europe had a movement, and both Europe and Japan created new things. And I think it was 1958 or 57, my father went to Europe. And he first time met the modernism.
For that matter,
after he thought about the contemporary art, he thought that we have to learn. Therefore, he invited a lot of the works from other than Japan. Mr. Jiro Yoshihara, my father, advisor of my father, Mr. Saito. These people really became my father's advisor. And Fontana, Incline, there is also the second generation who saw those works. They were really impressed. My father said, no, you cannot just copy. We have to really cultivate Japan's own. Therefore, he collected a lot of the artists who understand Zen. However, unfortunately, their works were not sold. But then Europe's modern art, contemporary art, were sold very well. That is because a lot of the new riches in Japan, manufacturer in Japan, their CEO tried to buy those works. At the end of the day, my father thought that Japan alone cannot do it all by ourselves. So he thought about collaborating with other countries, so he incorporated American and then China, and then also Art of Basel, Hong Kong. This is modernism or modern art or covering all over Asia. So I think if my father is still alive now, he will be surprised now. And I think he would understand why he worked so hard in Japan. I think he would be very happy to see Art Basel in Hong Kong. That is my brief answer to you.
Thank you. 接下来我换成用中文，想请问一下耿桂英女士跟张颂仁先生，因为你们两位都是画廊都在做跟中国现代跟当代艺术的关系。
2019年正好是五四运动的100周年，是中国近代现代化的开始。那耿女士，您的画廊呢，一直都蛮关注艺术家，而是都是二十世纪初期或中期到了巴黎去读书，可能留在那边了，或者回到中国去教书。那我想知道为什么您会为 画廊选择这些艺术家呢，因为在台北的画廊，这些艺术家其实跟台北并没有太大的关系，或者说跟台湾没有直接的地缘关系。那您的画廊，是因为藏家特别喜欢呢，还是说您觉得画廊的定位在这样子的这个市场，或者在这个台湾的这个环境里面很适合，然后如何又与国际接轨？大家好。
大家好，我是最早进入画廊产业大概三十年前左右，那时候台湾的一个非常非常的本土热，那个时候我们讲的是上万点，那时候市场是非常非常兴旺的。但是那时候我很有幸，很荣幸是我那时候进入这个艺术产业，我直接就是接轨了法国巴黎，然后那时候我主要经营就是巴黎画派。那时候这是我学到一个很重要的一个东西，就是说，其实那时候台湾的市场好像比较注重的跟学术的关系并不大。那我是从这个西方这个学习到研究的这个市场，跟学术的关系。那时候我就注意到了，其实这个所谓这种重要市场里面是有很强的学术在里面的。那时候我就研究了这样的一个西方哇这么庞大这么结构这么坚实的一个 学术那个结构，还有市场结构。所以这时候我就发觉到说，台湾其实早就在进行这样的一个市场的，但是是有一点太过local了。那这时候我当然知道说，那时候其实我就从那个现代主义这里进入，因为那时候很荣幸的在巴黎能够看到了藏域，看到了藻域，那个时候对我 说是一种震撼，因为尤其你在奥斯陶尔里面看到的旁边就是马蒂斯蒙内，尼什么图勒，看到一个藏域跟朱颜子，然后这里面充满了东方文人的精神。你可以想想那时候，你看到一个是用毛笔的画油画的艺术家，那尤其我第一眼看到藏域的时候，这是我发现到中国第一个现代主义作品，那时候我在台湾还没看到，可是我却在巴黎看到，所以那时候 其影响很大，所以那时候我就决定往这方向来走。所以在1996年的时候，我就搬出了一个民初美术史的开拓者。 因为我本身我父亲乃至中国，我出生在台湾，然后那种强烈的文化的东西在我身上，所以那时候我就从好奇，我这出生台湾，或者这些
那这个展览也体验到，的确就是这个流日的艺术家，那一种表现的那种艺术面貌跟这个文化的那种表现方式。所以那时候办了这样的一个展览，那这个展览也体验到，的确就是这个流日的艺术家，那一种表现的那种艺术面貌跟这个文化的那种表现方式。所以那时候办了这样的一个展览，那这个展览也体验到，的确就是这个流日的艺术家，那一种表现的那种艺术面貌跟这个文化的那种表现方式。所以那时候办了这样的一个展览，那这个展览也体验到，的确就是这个流日的艺术家，那一种表现的那种艺术面貌跟这个文化的那种表现方式。所以那时候办了这样的一个展览，那这个展览也体验到，的确就是这个流日的艺术家，那一种表现的那种艺术面貌跟这个文化的那种表现方式。所以那时候办了这样的一个展览，那这个展览也体验到，的确就是这个流日的艺术家，那一种表现的那种艺术面貌跟这个文化
especially when it comes to, you know, ethnic Chinese artists. In Asia, I think there is not a comprehensive study or work has not enough work has been done on ethnic Chinese artists, so, well, at least when I was working on it. So I wanted to start working on that, but up until now, I'm still working in that direction, you know,
if, when I discovered 还有像我王怀宪、苏小博、彭威，包括我这次展的这个蒋友梅， 其实都在这脉络里面， 包括我这次带来的王盘元， 也是在这个脉络里面，所以这个是我一直在深耕，也是会持续做下去的。
Thank you so much.
Johnson,
when I first came to Hong Kong and I saw the 35th anniversary show, retrospective show of Hanart Gallery, and you did also do a lot of archival work of modernism. We saw the calligraphy of Yu Youren and Kang Youwei and Liang Jingshan's picture, and also paintings during Cultural Revolution, regardless of paint, ink and wash or oil.
So I think you are positioned in a very special one, a special time for Hong Kong and for Taiwan, and for mainland you had a lot of care. So there are still a little distance, and yet this is very closely related. So can you please explain, you know, your work at the Hanart Gallery, it is very complicated because you have the three places along the street, the conflict and the relationship between 这些展览，还有这么多年来。
And how do you, during all these years, how do you
go about strategizing your exhibitions? Thank you for your question. Your question actually asked me to reflect on what is it that I have done. Of course, I care a lot about modernism. But frankly speaking, my interest in modernism is not as big as my interest in modernity, and the two has a difference. For visual arts, it is an expression of the different progresses. And this is something that China must face. I mean, what I'm talking about is the modernity and the change to modernity. So modernism, for me, must face the changes in civilization and the awareness change of the aesthetics. So I feel that many people these days are combing through the theories of modernism, especially the linear analysis, those are very important. But it does not necessarily become a target per se, because we are facing the results of the technology advancements of the day, and also the entire ecology of ideology, you know, from colonialism to today. And the facts of the West, this is something that we must face. Not for me, unless it is absolutely necessary, you don't have to go down the modernism track. Because it indeed in itself is a linear analysis. So if the artists, indulges themselves in modernism, it may not be a good path. So I think we have to face what we have to. You know, we cannot let go of our roots. So my interest does not really start from art history. I have looked into a lot more other works that does not, you know, look like a piece of artwork. For example, propaganda, folk arts, documentary movies, or maybe even, you know, some other representations that are related to art history. So I would ask you other questions
Amna,
later on. Amna.
My question is, well, I know that you've been a vital force in pushing forward exhibitions and discussions of South Asian artists, especially Pakistani artists, around the world and in Hong Kong specifically, where you live. I wanted to know how have you defined your mission or task for your own collection, but also for the foundation work that you have been doing in relation to modernism in Pakistan.
So one thing I'd like to mention in terms of the context of modernism in Pakistan, and Pakistan is a relatively young nation, it's 70 years old, but it has a 3,000-year-old past. So modernism is twofold. In Pakistan, artists have done two things. One is that they've connected with tradition. That was in itself a form of rebellion, and I will mention that how that was. And the other thing is that they have broken away from tradition. And modernism is usually defined as breaking away from tradition. But in the Pakistani context, it was also about connecting. Because if we go back in history, we see that there's an image I'm showing of an artist called Abdurrahman Chughtai, who was the first modernist. And if you look at his paintings, they appear very representative. There are figures and all there. But what was interesting was that because at that time, India and Pakistan were both colonized, and there was the Mughal miniature had been put aside, the older traditions, and it was basically an very British-style art curriculum. So to break away from that and connect to tradition and look at your past, that in itself was the essence of modernism there. And then on the second hand, his use of Japanese gouache techniques, again, was another act where Pakistani modernists were learning not only from the West, but from the East as well. And breaking away, and that form of rebellion or that breaking away was breaking away from that tradition of company school or British school style painting or Indo-European painting, as it was called at that time. And as far as the collection goes, I do collect a lot of, I'll speak in terms of the collection in terms of modernism and contemporary. The heart of the collection is contemporary, but there is, we began collecting modern art, and the reason for that was because I felt it would connect to the other portions of the collection in terms of the contemporary art. And the modernist artists had set such an amazing example of what could be done in a new nation that I felt they really needed to be represented in the collection. So artists like Sadiq Ain, for example, whose work you'll see here, or Zahoor-ul-Ikhlaq, all of them, I think, again, is that dual mode. They would connect to tradition, so they would connect to things like calligraphy, but with calligraphic abstraction. And then, so for example, works that I've shown here of Zahoor-ul-Ikhlaq, of Shamza, of Shakir Ali, they looked at that, but then contemporary artists are looking at those again, following from that tradition. So, therefore, how the collection moves forward will be both a story of the modernists and the contemporary artists, because I think without each other, they don't make much sense. And one thing I would like to point out is that there is an image that is shown here, which is from 1851. It's an image of a miniature painting, and it depicts the festival of Holi. And the artist has basically thrown paint and used complete abstraction in something which is so representative. So I think modernism had an history in Asia before Europe. I mean, this could be something very controversial to say, but I will. And then in the end, you have a work by a miniature painter called Imran Qureshi, where he goes back to using that similar gestural abstraction in that same way. So I think that arc kind of moves between modern and contemporary. And as a custodian of this collection, of the Arn collection, my main role will be, and which has been in the past 20 years, will be to take the story of modernism and contemporary art from Pakistan and present it to the world.
This is a very interesting lineage from the modern to contemporary. David, you've been instrumental in excavating and researching the works by Sino-Thai artist Tang Chang. And as a curator and a critic, can you share the experience of contextualizing his work in frameworks such as the Thai art, Southeast Asian art, and international? I know you've encountered quite a lot of different kinds of attempts or agendas in contextualizing his work. So I hope you can share with us about the challenges and the discoveries.
Sure. Thank you for having me. I'd like to start by not talking about Chang, but I will get to it. I think it's worth maybe noting the composition of our conversation here, the panel. It was interesting to me to reflect on an invitation from the fair to speak amongst some of the titans of the field, real pioneers in breaking, if you like, Asian modernism. They're people who, none of us are strangers to the so-called primary market. I think that's interesting. There's one museum person on the stage. She's the moderator. Everyone else is a little closer to the market, let's be frank. Me, probably less. I'm at least the least profitable person on the stage. But I think it's worth noting this because it tells you something about where the knowledge is. It tells you something about how knowledge production on this subject happens in this part of the world. My own interest in Asian modernism, I didn't study it, comes from a wish to understand the contemporary, actually. And the artist who I've been asked to talk about, Chang Se Tang, or Tang Chang, was a Chinese-Thai artist whose work I discovered actually relatively late in my research, maybe about six or seven years ago. I knew of this artist. I had not seen much of his work in the flesh, for many of the same reasons that, undiscovered Asian modernist masters lie buried in many countries. One of the interesting things about Southeast Asia, where I have been working and where my research is focused, that I think distinguishes it from East Asia, and while I won't speak for Southeast Asia, I think it's important to underscore this. In Southeast Asia, as far as I'm aware, there are no Johnsons, there are no Tina Kengs, there are no Yamamoto-sons, right? And this is, therefore, the entry of Southeast Asian modernist art into the kinds of circulation that we're starting to see now transnationally came about through mostly quite different avenues to the ones that my fellow panelists will be speaking about. So it's really a kind of frontier site. One of the things that I think I should flag that's very important to that region, but also in my own work, is that the role of the nation state and the role of public institutions is not really something that we've had to even think about. Most of the interesting modernists, certainly the modernists who, according to a kind of conventional art historical way of identifying pioneers, who were pioneering artists, often the national institutions have shown very little interest in them. And still, that's still the case in many places. So this is perhaps another of the particularities of working in that part of the world. Institutions have not really been available for our consultation. They can't teach us anything about these artists, and so you really have to start from scratch. My own interest in this artist began as a researcher, and I have continued to to write about his work. But we really needed to start from scratch, so that meant talking to the family, trying to find sources of some very modest funding to simply inventory what the family was holding. Tang Chang died in the 90s, and he was an artist who always stayed away from the institutions of the day. He's an artist whose oeuvre is almost wholly kept together. Right, so this is another very peculiar thing. His work was not sold. He was not ever really interested in selling his work, a handful of pieces here and there. So there's really, I think for me, this is probably the last thing I'll mention, a great opportunity here to undo patterns of identification of modernism, right, in art historical discourse, in art criticism, and so on. Precisely because this work has not yet entered into a kind of discursive exchange. And so I think it's really almost like a Pandora's box situation. And that was why I was interested. I was interested in particular in the corrosive effect that an artist like this might have on existing sort of dominant ways of historicizing Thai art.
And that's why when the work was shown at the Shanghai Biennale in 2014, I think it raised a lot of questions for a lot of people. How do you even place this in any narrative? Since you raised the question about institutions, I want to pose that question to all the other panelists as well. Can you tell us a bit more about your relationship with institutions such as universities, scholarship, or museums in the particular areas you work in? 我的问题是关于你们的工作，你们的这个领域。
My question is about what is the relationship that you have in the course of your work to the academia, to the institutions, or to the exhibitions, museums? 我们先从这个山本先生。
Audience that you had, from your father's time until later on in the 70s, 80s, who are your scholars, who are your institutions?
Well, in Japan, museum was established. It was after the gallery was established. So my father, the Kanagawa Modern Art Museum, that is in 1951, and my father helped a lot for establishment of this museum. So we are talking about modernism in Asia. The most important thing is that art will be. So art has to establish as a product. Okay? Otherwise, you cannot collect so many works. You talk about Thai artists. There will be always a time gap. Okay? There will be art, and then it becomes sellable products. There is a time gap. That's why Nichido Gallery was established. So the art is sold as a product. Actually, the artist, I have to understand, and also have an information that somebody will buy your product, buy your art, and then they will. It's their profession to sell your art. And my brother in 1989 went to Beijing. Well, at that time, Shupin. Publishing his art, and it was exhibited in the museum. And my brother asked him, "Are you selling this?" And then they said, "Okay, I will sell." That's why my brother bought it, and then he brought it back to Japan. And at that time, well, you have to understand that because someone sold us, and then we bought the art. That's why those art came to Japan. When I first came to Hong Kong, well, the antique exchange was very, very popular.
So
what I thought is that when I talk about modernism, we have to understand the capitalism and the art. We have to make a comprehensive review for that. and then museum and also, gallery, we all have to review in their position. That's what I think.
Amna, do you want to continue?
Yes, as far as Pakistan goes, the Pakistan National Council of Arts and the National Art Gallery has quite a substantial collection of modern art, but I think that is the only institution. There are some in the Lahore Museum as well, but modernist artists were collected, but not with a lot of zeal. So when we started collecting, though modernism is before my time and contemporary, that's why, like I said, contemporary art is something that appeals to me because it's the stories of this time, but we made a conscious effort to collect modern artists. And the reason for that was that I wanted to bring them all into the collection from different parts of the world or works that were there in Pakistan, because I wanted there to be at least one repository of knowledge where there, for some of the modern artists, like for example for Sadiq N, or for Gulji, we would have such a large oeuvre of work that it would basically such in-depth collection that could be studied, that could be researched, and that could be shown. So I think the role that we played was basically to collect the moderns and then show them as well. So there was an exhibition we had in Hong Kong, and this is that time when modernists, people had kind of forgotten the modernists. So we did two exhibitions here actually, and we showed three modern artists, and the reaction here was phenomenal actually, because I think people really responded to those works again, because it was those artists which had been forgotten and those being reintroduced, and it wasn't just in Hong Kong, because now everything, because of technology, is so connected that people in Pakistan, after a while as well, were able to see that there has been an exhibition and there has been a publication on those works. So therefore, that was one role we played in getting modern histories of modern art together.
Johnson, 您刚说您是情非得已的要展现代主义，那您很早就开始做画廊了，那您当时跟比如说香港的博物馆啊，或者是学术机构，或者跟中国大陆跟台湾的这些学术机构，博物馆有些什么样的互动？我说情不得已的是关于创作的问题，大家觉得一个东西是刺激的。 有是个兴奋点，我觉得这个是一个很完满的一个动机去走一个方向。可是作为一个潮流来说，我觉得我们还是要冷静一点来重新思考创作的目的跟道路。机制来说是。
创作者他在创作的时候，他想象的理想的换种姿势，因为每一个创作的人，他都有一个新民主国家，还是一个abstract new utopia，或者是social institution，可是从一种动机变成了一个造型的时候，这个就比较复杂，因为每一个造型本身会有带来自己的历史，所以对造型的使用，这些其实都不同的机构观点。
actually has to do with different institutions. So for us, the art museum institution in China in the 1990s started to undergo sea changes before. Prior to that, in mainland China, there were very, very few art museums, most of them were just collections. Most of the collections they had were, you know, archaeological objects, ancient objects. But right now, I think you have regular national art exhibitions and also in different media, different formats. But in socialist China, and how it categorized, cataloged art, it is quite different from contemporary art. As we know it, lots of craft art, they have different platforms. So these platforms started to, in the course of 1990s, Institutions do shape or inform the trend in creativity, in creative output. So what kind of institutions, what kind of institutions we built? We need to think very carefully. Especially in China, institutions are all new since the 1990s. A lot of private galleries, private collections, private art museums. So the key question is, do we still need something like in the West, regardless it's being private or public, art museum, MoMA, or that kind of categorization, you know, artists and that kind of reincarnation. So in the last century in China, political and ideological as well, sort of our imaginings of the world, do we have to bring people washed into kind of another path, sort of closely emulated on what the West has gone through? So private collections, private galleries, you know, we still need to think about it. For example, in Hong Kong doesn't have that kind of historical treatment because history is expensive to rent. If you rent a space to build an art museum, it's virtually impossible. In China, it's extremely feasible. Space is an absolute condition. So you have to think about from the transition from socialist China to a capital-run capital. And you also have to be based on new society and consumerism, consumption. And sort of the societal change, the paradigm change, have we, within the context of this social change, what have we lost?
就才从, 社会主义里面, 有什么值得流动性是丢掉,
what kind of 而是给, legacies of socialism
给资本,
that are actually have been transformed by capital into sort of modes of consumption?
比方说,
I think that's how I would think about space.
社会主义中国,
so in socialist China, a lot of key public spaces such as
青少年文化宫,
the youth culture palaces,
老年文化宫,
youth, or senior citizens cultural center, and a lot of local archives have all disappeared. They have all but disappeared, and the spaces have been sort of transformed into the private or commercial sort of developers' projects. So,
从公共空间变成了一个消失的公共空间，我觉得应该是现在要改变的一个方面，要好好思考。尤其在座肯定都是很多有能力盖私人的人，所以可能一个需要思考的就是。
Key question we have to ask ourselves. China does have a huge enthusiasm for art museums, and actually our Basel Hong Kong is sold out. It's unimaginable. You'll come in, you'll buy stuff, and then you still have to pay for entry. So it means people have such enthusiasm for art, for seeing artworks. It's
a kind of
frenzied state. I don't want to see craze, because then you don't want to spend money.
But
if there is such a strong need for art, desire for art, why? We have to ask ourselves why in China a lot of people, quite a lot of people were asked. They have such expectations for art spaces, and within such expectations, is it because the last few decades transition to a lot of public spaces catering to their needs have disappeared, and then you only have art spaces that meet their needs. So the art museum, the role they play is extremely burdened, and we need to really start to think how to develop them further into subdivision. This is probably is what I want to respond to David Tez's discussion about the institution. I would like to ask Ms. Keng, if I may presumptuously ask you, a lot of the artists that you exhibited are quite expensive, so institutions won't be able to afford them. So can you please share with us, in terms of, because there are, there's a need for the circulation of works, you want the public to be able to see it. Johnson also, you should also ask Johnson's questions, but he kind of just didn't really respond to it. So Ms. Gen, can you please further elaborate on that? I was lucky. I was fortunate to have grown up in Taiwan. So in 1983, the earliest municipal art museum of Taipei, the most important art space for ethnic Chinese artists. So I want to further discuss the relationship between myself and our gallery. So I'm first generation Taiwanese. So for me, Taiwanese art museums actually very focused on this. They focused on the senior, local artists. And I think my métier, my strength, so to speak, is ethnic Chinese modernism. The reason I took this path, just as what Johnson has said, it's because it's Western, but ethnic Chinese people have done those works. In 1932, he was invited to MoMA, Pan Yuliang was already in Paris in 1921, so they actually were active back then, and they had creative output. So I would like to, the country was focused also, had to do with the national fortune back then, so I was lucky to be able to see it. I want to tell you that there was, they cost only a fraction of what it is now. It's all these auctioneers and all these bankers are trying to create this kind of price surge. I didn't sell them such a high price. I think the prices that you see talked about that museums cannot afford them, but I know for a fact that some private art museums actually 可能要靠私人美术馆来展示这些所谓的华人现代主义这一块。那当然，如果说假如能够有政策像美国一样，对不对？我买作品可以去瑞士，可以捐赠，所以你看，现在纽约世界的那个艺术市场第一名。现在香港好像越具第二、第三之间了啊。那为期待说，如果说假如哪个国家政府非常重视我们艺术文化这一块，您可以实施这个政策，我保证我。 Really, do that. I mean, I can sell you 10 works if the policies, right policies are in place, you know.
No, actually, David actually started this question, but I wanted to bounce it back to everyone, but please feel free to jump in.
Please feel free to join in.
Because everyone more or less talked about the interaction between the area that you're in, whether it's Tokyo or Pakistan, or Japan, Pakistan, China, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and Thailand or Southeast Asia. And I don't want to generalize you, but this is how we're doing this right now. A lot of the artists that you are working with or you have worked with are very important in the histories, our histories of your location. But they also have very strong interactions with, for instance, people are in Paris, artists were in Paris, artists were in America. So how do you deal with this kind of intersections and the ways that they have been contextualized, perhaps not so much in those later home countries, or how do you see them being framed in the larger context? I think both of you wanted to answer immediately, so you can decide.
The characteristics of Japanese museum is that the collection of Western art, the biggest collection, is held by Japan's museums. And at the same time, we have a lot of collections from China as well. This is before contemporary. Well, in Japan, for a long, long time, they had a lot of collections. However, what we lack most is Asian arts. In Fukuoka, we have a modern museum. There is only one out of, you know, out of a lot of museums in Japan. Only one is collecting Southeast Asian works. So going forward, I think Japan has to supplement and together with you, and then we have to bring from Southeast Asia the works and show it to Japanese public. That is very important. And also, we have a lot of Western artists' works, and we also have to think about how to display those for a lot of the people. I think the biggest problem in Japan is how to make use of what we have. Should we just keep it in the museum without showing it? So I think that is the biggest challenge for Japanese museums, how to show all the collections. And then that cannot be done by just one museum. So I think in that sense, I think it is very important we have to connect with other museums in other countries. So, you know, people are smart, so they think, oh, okay, I go to Art Basel, then I can see more Asian artists. Then they will come here. So I think that's what we have to think about, how to, you know, reinvigorate the market in Japan or museums in Japan.
Mr. Yamamoto just spoke about that inter-Asian dialogue, which I think is extremely important. And that was the reason, actually, in the beginning, why we bought exhibitions off and supported exhibitions in Hong Kong from Pakistan because of that absence of inter-Asian dialogue. But going back to your question about Western institutions, so most of the artists that the modern artists who set up the basis for modernism in Pakistan after getting their basic undergraduate education in Pakistan at the National College of Arts, which was a British school, British art school type curriculum and set up by the British, most of them then went to the UK at the Royal College of Art, at Slade School of Art, at the École de Paris. So most of the artists you see, the modernists who form the spine of modernism in Pakistan, actually went and received education there. And it's interesting, one of the artists, Zahurul Ikhlaq, who I feel is someone who brought back that link to tradition which had been broken, was studying at the Royal College of Arts, but in his spare time would visit the British Museum and look at traditional miniatures. And that then came back into his work. So that connection is there. And I think in terms of showing modern art, it was shown a great deal in the 60s and 70s in the UK. In fact, Anwar Jalal Shamza was being shown in Gallery One. They were having exhibitions in New York, in Washington, in Paris. Sadiq Khan was the laureate, the biennial in Paris in 1961. So that dialogue was there. And then for that period of that fractious period of 15 years where nothing much was happening and when contemporary art then came back, now there is a great dialogue between both Western and Asian museums in showing contemporary artwork. So I think that connection with Europe and the US has been there. And I think there's a great need for that inter-Asian dialogue and for artists from Asia to be showing. From that could be East Asia, South Asia, Southeast Asia, West Asia, to be shown in institutions. In the region.
Kind of comparative or the kind of inter-regional dialogues are hopefully going to be something that we all can work towards.
It's your turn again.
So
just now we were discussing
各自每一个每一位台上的讲者自己在负责
的
比较专注的这些艺术家们跟如何跟外界的有一些关系，我想您很早就带了许多展览，不管是把大陆艺术家展览带到香港，或者说像台湾艺术家的作品带到香港，或者说把像中国艺术家的作品带到威尼斯等等，您其实做了很多这样的工作，可以请您告诉我们，您觉得就说在这样子比较国际化的框架下，您如何去处理这样子的其实是非常当地的一些作品，
中国 rooted works。
我在不同时代做的事情有些有点不太一样。我最早开始在80年代的时候呢，我的主要的兴趣是把中国艺术家，无论是港台的艺术家，希望把他们不是介绍出去的问题，而是希望把他们放到一个现在的西方大家国际上西方认同的一个平台上面，因为这个是对。他们艺术家本身的自我的肯定的一个非常重要的一个后来到了90年代，这是一个已经是一个通行现象。后来我就做了一些在做的是其他的事情为主。不过刚才两位谈的一个非常重要的一个现象就是，我们在因为今天都是主要以亚洲为主。好像我们亚洲人，我们最贴近的邻居是西方。这个是一个整个现代问题里面的很重要的现象。在我们现在需要呢，要找些更隔壁的邻居。
is to find our closest neighbor。
东亚需要。
For example, East Asia. We need to understand each other better, especially contemporary.China, it's not possible to have to do without Japan. Even in our language, we would find a translation into Japanese first. And in South Asia, and Pakistan, and India, we now have more respect for the Nirvana, from Pakistan and India. It was where we get our Buddhist Sutra.What I mean is culturally we are closer, so we need to find a position to understand each other. And more importantly is to understand more about ourselves, more understanding about our cultural heritage.
童女士，您在就是推广第一代华人旅法，或者说在旅美的艺术家来说，您怎么看？跟其他亚洲地区的机构啦，或者是就做一些这样的交流，因为其实比如说常玉或赵无极等等，大概都只有在华人地区比较受到重视。虽然赵无极很早在就1958年就到了日本跟日本的艺术家有很多交流，那有一些这样子的区域内的一些艺术家交流的想法。
So what kind of network did you build?
未来是不是如此交流的？那其实是有西方的这个单位已经邀请我进行去参展了，这些项目有五大语嘛。那我就因为我毕竟还是一个个人民间的力量，我就是不可能一下子发展的广阔。那我觉得我必须把这个脉络给更扎实下来。那我当然也其实也在跟像你说像那个美国西雅图的美术馆也合作过，那跟日本的兵库美术馆也合作过，虽然合作的这个像是王怀信和苏小白，那在国内的那个美术馆我也合作过很多间啊，在北京、上海、广州、苏州这样子几个主要美术馆我都合作过，而且也当然我认为先应该先希望，我希望在亚洲里面最重要的一个华人里面先关注影响你本身的艺术、本身的文化、本身的美术史跟西方产生的关系。我要梳理是这个我们华人里面的那个艺术家，跟那是1921年乾隆卷钱团第一批派到法国的，他们去的目的是什么？吸取了西方的经验回来，对不对？他们的新的观念回来，然后影响。那不可否认，其实他并没有完全受西方影响，他还是融入这个母体的那个深厚。
of course, one can't say that they have, you know, they have been totally indulged in the Western ideas, but they have brought back, you know, these culture to our motherland, and I have been trying to organize, you know, this network. Many people are very interested in this. They are interested in both the Chinese aesthetic, the Asian aesthetics, as well as its relationship with the West.
David, I know you have some interesting experiences making exhibitions of Tang Chang outside of his origin. Can you talk a bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, this was a very deliberate strategy on our part. We, as I mentioned, the institutional landscape was not very encouraging in Thailand. The market was also not interested in this sort of artist. And so, in fact, we were actually forced overseas in the first instance. Of course, there is interest in Thailand in this artist, but what are they going to do with it? Do they have the means, whether they're public or private, do they have the means to really develop some knowledge about this artist? And I did not feel that the mechanisms or the organisations or the knowledge were in place for that. We managed to get a little bit of support from the Haus der Kultur und der Welt in Berlin to do some of the basic research. But fortunately for us, for myself and the family, a lot of curators wanted to show the work. So exhibiting the work actually became the sharp end of the research spear, which I know is a little bit back to front, right? But showing these works became the way to generate the enthusiasm and the capital required to actually reinvest in finding out where it came from, in finding out about its origins and about the artist himself. So there's since been some 6 or 7 years of that process. We have inventoried a large majority of the objects and a small minority of the works on paper that this artist produced in his lifetime. To answer your previous question about context, I think it's very important that these artists' works are shown outside of the parochial national art historical environment, partly because those artists were not necessarily thinking or operating in such a parochial village. You know, this maybe it's useful for us to distinguish here between internationalism and transnationalism. And I think the default setting of Asian art history has largely been about national art histories, as in Western art history for a certain period. The history of, if you like, arts globalization or modern arts globalization has been a history of nations meeting. Right? And this is absolutely not the terms in which many of these artists encountered artworks from elsewhere. These were artists sitting in their living room reading a magazine sometimes, right? The nation state has no mediating role in that encounter. Same goes for the artists who have travelled or studied abroad, right? Often it's not the nation state that has kind of furnished that experience, right? So I think it's very important for us to tell transnational stories for these artists, and this is one of the things the international appetite, if you like, or the global appetite for Tang Chang's work allowed us to do, is to actually think of his work and historicize it beyond the national frame. And I think that's been, for me, one of the great sort of liberating discoveries of the process.
Well, since we're at this place called Art Basel, we should talk about market. And I think that's also why they put us all on this stage. Well, regarding the works that you are most specialized in, how much does market matter and which market matters? So maybe, David, do you want to start first?
Sure. I mean, I think I've just answered it in a way. I think the national market will always matter in these things, but I don't think it's... I don't think you don't want that to become the destination of the process. And so in my case, it was not only fortunate, but I think very, very important that the desire came from outside first. right? Now, this in Thailand, as in many other colonial or pseudo-colonial, post-colonial places, that foreign interest is very important. It's a validation, it's an affirmation of the importance of the artists and the works. This means that you can develop a sort of currency or develop a sort of interest in the work that means that the local and the national cannot treat it like rubbish, right? And what they would want is to kind of march in and take hold of a lot of works for some badly run national institution, which without doing any research, et cetera, et cetera. So I think it's been crucial that there be an international or transnational kind of marketing before that discussion happens at the national level. Is the market important? Of course, it always will be, I think. You can't pretend otherwise. But I don't think that... I don't think that it always will unfold in the same way. And in some cases, I think reversing the flows or switching places or markets is a very, very useful and advantageous thing to do.
Ms. Keng, do you like to answer this question?
市场重要吗? 哪个市场比较重要?
Is the market important? If yes, which one? Market is hugely important. You know, I like to be very direct. You know, whether you know, can you sell well in the market? Recommend shows that whether you're recognized, and it also shows that whether you can continue to do your business. You know, when at the beginning, when I started my work, it wasn't something that's been recognized. It was hugely difficult. It was my passion, my commitment that has drove me to continue. You know, I'm not exaggerating. Look at my exhibit, my auction catalog. It is only 1% of what it is today. So with this viewpoint, I think it seems that now we have become an important player in Chinese modernism, and perhaps the highest price. But I think, you know, this is only just the beginning. In the future, we will have more and more better and better artists. You know, if we can, you know, if I am taking the lead, then it definitely means that there would be a lot better to come, and I think the latter waves would be larger ones, of course. Your support, your collection, your buying is, of course, the most important. Mr. Zhang? Now, modernist creation is under a globalized capitalist economy. You know, if it comes from this context, then, of course, the circulation of art pieces
is
a part of the capital and goods flow in the globalized world and the capitalized world. Therefore, the size of its circulation and the price definitely has to do with the identity of the artist. Of course, and this is not the only measurement. I believe that in creation and in art, in the artistic field, especially looking into China, the elder generation of the artists sometimes felt quite ironic. You know, say you were talking about this Thai artist who refused to sell his work, but for a creator, you know, being recognized, whatever way it is important. In the capitalized market, in the capitalistic market, price is, of course, an important index. But there are also other important index too. So on this platform, how should I put it? It is one of the key elements.
I would think, yes, the market is extremely important, and as David said, that it, Johnson said, sorry, that it basically allows for the circulation of those materials. So, obviously the market consists of galleries and auction houses and art fairs, and one important thing to note is that because of that, the work is seen as well. So apart from the work being bought and sold, I think the other mechanism that the market serves is also to see. So like Johnson just mentioned, people are coming in to buy the works, but then there are people buying tickets to see the works as well. So I think the market serves that role in both, because I think the main, the crux of art is the looking. And it can be the possessing or of just the way of seeing as well. And of the like I said in the beginning, the market is important, but I think that framework of continuous research, looking into art histories, what the institutions are doing is as, if not as, more important. I think it's critical. Museum shows, universities doing research, art histories being studied, along with the circulation of the artworks, I think makes for a very robust art scene.
Yamamoto-san.
Hi.
Yes, there are two encounters. Art fair, actually, this is the encounter of works. And then the other is encounter with artists. Well, from Mr. Tsuguji Fukuda, and then your people also met in Paris. So modernists has met each other in Europe. But now we can choose in China, Munkenbunma, your Thai person, Thai artist, I can meet directly. So I think it is very important that Asia can create a venue for the artists to encounter with each other. Well, it was Paris first, and then New York, and then next was Berlin. A lot of the artists congregated these places. But is there a platform currently in Asia where the artists congregate? So I think now it is very important that people congregate. But then artists congregate, and then they can influence each other, they can stimulate each other. I think that is very important. So these two, we have to really think about it. Everything is absorbed by market, and no artist can grow. That is not a good thing. So we have to really distinguish these two encounters.
I think it's very interesting what Yamamoto-san has said, because again, the art, we have Art Basel going on right now, and so many artists from all over the world are all gathered, and they are, there is that conversation with the artworks as well as with each other. So I think that also makes for robust art.
The academic side of me sort of worries about this kind of canonization of artists. I mean, of course, I also specialize in modernist art history of Taiwan and looking comparatively, but I mean, rarely we have the pioneering gallerists sitting together. So I wanted to ask what was left out of your gallery roster, you know, what do you do with that? I think David's case is kind of a telling story of that. What was left out of the history? What's left out of the story? And are you conscious of the fact that for the gallerists on the stage, are you conscious of the fact that when you put up an exhibition, whether it's a group exhibition or a solo exhibition of a certain movement or a certain group of artists, that you're at the same time canonizing them? I think this is a question pegged closely to my previous question about the market and how conscious of you as you formulate these kind of stories, and what do you treat the repercussions of that? Who wants to take the first hit? Johnson, I'm looking at you. Please go first.
But there are many ways of giving visibility to artists. Through the art market is one. And if I give something to the auction market, it disappears from, it's out of my control. The auction house creates the narrative. But the exhibition I create, there's another story. But of course, there are exhibitions you create as well. And so there are different narratives that make art history. And of course, I can well understand the complaint of artists today is that there are some types of really good art, very maybe cutting edge and to the point, and they are not visible on the commercial market because they can't sell, and they
by the time they do sell, the artists may no longer be in need of it because a lot of them might have been dead by then. So the visibility and canonization, I think, is a very complex issue. And I do think it's a problem when market confirmation takes over the a more considered appraisals and valorization of artists. But then there has a lot to do with our whole system of art institutions. Back to the question that David brought up in the first place, because the whole structure of modern museums, the way we use museums, like the Federal Reserve of Culture, canonizing. Oh, sorry, I was supposed to speak in Chinese. Canonizing art in a way that ensures the value, that itself, and it's also the structure of a lot of modern museums in the fact that they need to be supported by patrons, and so they are. But at least that is actually more in the background. So the whole structure of museum and narrative making and canonization is a process that. I suppose it's always a struggle of the scholar against the power of money and the power of influence. But then we should also think how we should change the museum platform as well.
I think the market is very important. 常玉第一次上那个拍卖在 1992年 台北的时候 那个知名度是不一样的 那个被公开的 接着在那个同年的艺术博览会 我们把常玉给端出来 整个能见度被看见了 所以我觉得这个是光靠一个gallery 或一个museum 那个展览 那个就比较局限在学者跟收藏圈之内 所以我认为它必须要有多方面的 包括媒体
报道之类的，所以我觉得那个对我来讲是感受最鲜明的。从以前求人家买东西，到后面人家排队求你卖他东西，感受特别深刻。Yamamoto-san,
so the question was about artists, you know, within the canon, and I think also for you is very special because you, as Tokyo Gallery, was the first gallery to show many of these artists now hugely canonized in the art histories, and a lot of other galleries in Japan and Korea, as well as in the U.S. and the Europe, are showing your artists and trying to turning them into a whole different mark and sensation. So how do you treat this kind of, I mean, obviously you can't control it, but this is how naturally it has evolved. So maybe you can share with us what you thought.
Well, particularly if you look at the young people in Japan, they are not taught how the Japanese modernism was developed. So the context of Japanese modernism, how do we send a message to these young people? How should it should be inherited by these young people are important. For example, this time in the Art Basel Hong Kong, I have made my own research in France or Italy, you know, what modernism, you know, influenced these countries. So I think Zen Yei Sho, for example, Mathieu, this is a French artist. So I really researched in this venue, and then I get some context. And then our gallery, based on that context, will see what is our future, what kind of exhibition we will have. And depending on the history, really, you know, you have to really link it with the history. Well, of course, I cannot meet all the artists. So first I will do is I will see the work, and then after that, if I like it, I think it's promising, then I will go see the artist. That's why every year I come here, because to Art Basel. So that's what I'm thinking. So going forward, you know, I will definitely that will influence our exhibition in Tokyo.
Discussion to the audience to ask questions. So this is your chance to ask specialists from very different regions, some intertwined, your burning questions about modernism and uncovering them. So do I see any hands up? The lady over there, please.
不好意思，我是台湾来的，水墨从事者啊，就是我是以水墨作为创作的艺术家。那我有一个问题想要问一下那个汉雅轩的Johnson，我觉得他今天一开始讲的那句话，我觉得我蛮有兴趣的，就是比起现代主义来讲，他更关心现代性。那我对这个现代性这个。
是有点兴趣哈，因为我个人在目前的创作的状态里面，我自身也是对现代性非常比较多的关注，也比较是偏向这方面的一个创作的方向。那是我想要就说请教一下Johnson他对于现代性，他有因为刚刚没有太多阐述，那问题是什么？ 就是希望，我希望Johnson能够再把所谓他对于现代性这样的一个观点，还有他能不能举例，就说以现代的某些水墨方面的艺术家，他觉得比较能符合他自己理想中他对于现代性的这种解释的艺术家，那么举个例子，谢谢。
我对于现代性，以我的理解是一个整个一个意识形态的一个政治的一个人的感知思维的整个的新的改造，而且是有一种特殊的特定的一种走向的一个社会的改进。那这个呢，也跟这几百年来的整个资本运作的一种新的方法，还有生产的新。 能量还有技术的变更有关系的，所以是在中国来说是必须面对的问题。在这个情景下面，艺术怎么发生变化？有些很主动的进入这种状态的，比方说政治运动。那么政治运动出现的艺术家，出现的艺术品，肯定就是在这个时代里面，能够可以说是带。 代表了我们今天所谓艺术品的一种功能的事情，比方说，在毛泽东年代的那种社会主义艺术，今天我们可以说是属于叫艺术品，在那个时代不是，它是代表了那个时代的一种美术的视觉的创作。
它是代表了时代的一种美术的视觉的创作。在宽一点来说，我觉得中国当代艺术家其实是有非常难的一个高墙要攀过去的。这个高墙攀过的不是西方的现代美术，他们攀不过毛泽东这个最极端的达达艺术家。
所以现代性才真正的角度来说呢，很多不是纯粹是关于文化传统那个基础。还有我对除了这种政绩，我对工艺品也很感兴趣，因为我觉得那个也是塑造我们今天怎么去面对新时代的。 一个给我们提供技师，提供技术的了解的一些资源，所以这个都是在考虑现代性问题的一些想到的事情。
我再开放一个问题。
I'm going to open up for another question.
请问有没有
any other members of the audience would like to, or anybody on the panel would like to ask each other?
The panelists questions for each other? Since there's no one wanting to take this. Oh, there's one. Last question.
Thank you. Thank you very much to everyone for your very illuminating comments. There's a lot of food for thought here. One of the things that I'm wondering about is the modern artists that you're familiar with, were they popularized through international collections or national collections? And the reason that I'm asking that is because it seems for contemporary art, being acquired internationally has become sort of a standard or a goal to achieve. And an analogy that I can think of is not in the art world, but in the music world, where one of the most brilliant music artists to come out of Pakistan, Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan, was more popular in Japan than in the masses in Pakistan. And from Japan, he went to Hollywood, and then he became supremely popular across all segments in Pakistan. So is it, you know, what's the parallel to that in the art world?
Amna, you want to start? Or is this a question for anyone particular? Okay. 想要回答这个问题的。いいですか?
多分ですね。
Well, this is an information society. People's decision is always input, and then he will output. And then at the moment, everybody in the world is same input. They have same information, same input. And then also plus where they were born, and then what culture they were in. So if you shut off the information, you cannot create anything without shutting out all the information. So it's not a polarization. It is really a sea of information we are in. And then each individual artist will come up, so there is a common thing. So you said Japanese people like this Pakistan music, and Japanese thought, oh, it's wonderful. So that means the creator in Pakistan and then the listener in Japan have got the same information. I think that is very important. So if you put same, if you get same input and then if you do the same thing, then that is not good. So you have to come up with your creative input. So I think that is the most important thing. I think we have to rethink about these kind of things again. Is it my, is it an answer to your question?
Amna, you want to take that too?
Yes. What I would like to say in the contemporary, I think because of technology, that's why that what you were talking about, the validation from outside the country, matters even more right now with contemporary artists, because the image and the works are being shown, the actual works, the images, it's being shown everywhere, and therefore that validation then became. But for modernists, I think, at least in the example of Pakistan, it was both. It was in the country as well as affirmation outside of the country. So I think at that time, because information and knowledge were not so widely disseminated, it stayed in that nation state, or maybe the three or four countries around it. Therefore, it was both. But now I think validation, international validation, becomes much more of a, much more, because you can't just be, to use the word famous, until unless you've had that. But I think earlier it was possible to have both, or maybe not even to have too much of that, but be very popular with the masses, like Sadiqan was. I mean, he had it, but I think he was very, very popular and rooted in the country. And I think Hussain, if you look at the Indian example, Hussain, Souza, Jamini Roy, all of those.
So I know we can continue for the entire afternoon, but unfortunately not right now. But I really would like to thank everyone on this panel. It's a very enriching conversation, especially when we are in this mecca of circulation at Art Basel. We're all here to learn about other people's modernism, other areas of modernism and contemporary in the history. And I hope in the future, not only we have Art Basel to see those things, but I hope you will all come to M+ to see the modernism across regions. Thank you. Thank you very much.